The statement by the Deputy First Minister. My apologies to the two members, I was unable to call. The next item of business is a debate on motion number 15282 in the name of Angela Constance on delivering a world-class education system. And I'll just give a few moments for people to get into their proper seats. Can I invite members who are staying for this debate and who wish to speak in the debate to press the request to speak button now? And I call on Angela Constance to speak to and move the motion. Cabinet Secretary, you have 14 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's a pleasure to open this debate, particularly at this time. It's the start of a new and exciting year for education in Scotland. Just 6 days ago, at the International Congress for School Effectiveness and Improvement in Glasgow, the First Minister launched the National Improvement Framework. And 4 weeks ago, the OECD published the review of our progress with Curriculum for Excellence. And we are extremely grateful to the OECD review team for their thoughtful and comprehensive reports entitled Improving Schools in Scotland, an OECD Perspective. And we very much welcome the report and its 12 recommendations, which provide us with a strong platform to help reach our goal of an excellent and equitable system, where every young person is able to achieve their full potential, irrespective of their background or needs. And it is important to reflect on the many strengths that the report highlights about Curriculum for Excellence. For example, it states that Curriculum for Excellence is an important reform to put in place a coherent 3-18 curriculum, which rests on widely accepted tenets of what makes for powerful learning. And the Deputy Director of the OECD's Directorate for Education and Skills, Montserrat Gomendio, said, "We applaud Scotland for having the foresight and patience to put such an ambitious reform as Curriculum for Excellence in place." And the OECD notes a picture of positive attitudes, engagement and motivation, partnerships outside the school, supportive ethos and teamwork, and that learners are enthusiastic and motivated, and teachers are engaged and professional, and system leaders are highly committed. And I am particularly heartened at the OECD's findings that our education is inclusive and our children are resilient. And this is exactly what Curriculum for Excellence is designed to foster. And I can assure members that our response to these positive endorsements, and indeed all of the recommendations, will be bold, focused and resolute. Presiding Officer, I think what parents and families around the country will recognise above all else is that schools are completely different now to what they were when they were at school, whether that be 10 or 20 years ago. And in my many visits to schools, I'm always struck by how confident, articulate and enthusiastic our children and young people are, and how they really own their own learning. And this is due in part to the freedom schools have with Curriculum for Excellence, the freedom to adopt a curriculum that is relevant to learners' needs, to local contexts and settings, and which builds on the teachers' expertise and talents, as well as the interests of learners. And Curriculum for Excellence has given us a broader, more flexible and child-focused curriculum. And it will ensure that young people have the opportunity to develop the right range of skills, qualifications and achievements to allow them to flourish. Learning at school is now exciting, stimulating, lively and crucially fun. Children are highly motivated and enthusiastic, teachers professional, engaged and committed. And all of this is delivering higher standards of achievement. And last year, there was a record number of passes at higher and advanced higher, and more young people received qualifications relating to wider skills for life and work. More students are staying on at school until 6 years. Fewer are leaving with very low or no qualifications, and all young people can now undertake relevant work-related learning as part of their curriculum. And now more than 9 out of 10 of last year's school leavers were in employment, education or training 9 months later. The OECD highlighted that... certainly.
Joanne Lamont.
If there's analysis of the 1 out of 10, what proportion of the 1 out of 10 who haven't got satisfactory destinations have come from those poor and deprived backgrounds in Scotland?
Ms. Constance.
I think, Ms. Lamont, you would know as well as I do that the relationship between young people not in positive destinations and their socioeconomic background will indeed be very high. And one of the things that I've worked on, along with our colleagues in the Fair Work and Youth Employment and Skills, is to move towards a more meaningful real-time measurement of where individual young people are in terms of positive destinations. And it was this government that was, of course, committed to opportunities for all. And it was this government that led the way across the UK in introducing opportunities for all, ensuring that there was an entitlement for every 16 to 19-year-old in this country of a place in education or training who required one. Signing officer, the OECD highlighted that Scotland has an historic high regard for learning, education and teachers, and the trust it invests in teachers' professional judgment is an admirable counterbalance to the trend in many other systems. The quality of our teaching workforce and the excellence of our educational leadership provide the bedrock of our education system. And as a government, we will continue to do all that we can to support and strengthen teacher professionalism. And that's why we are investing in our teachers and initial teacher education and professional learning and in maintaining the numbers of teachers working in our schools. It's also why we have worked with partners to embed the core ideas of Teaching Scotland's Future and will continue to do so through a new strategic board for teacher education. And we've all... Of course...
I'm very grateful for the Cabinet Secretary giving way. She rightly made the point about teacher professionalism. Would she recognise that in her new head teacher qualification, it's important to recognise the difference between rural authorities with rural schools and small schools and the larger schools and the difficulty sometimes of recruitment given that narrow qualification requirement?
I do indeed appreciate that there are particular challenges for rural communities, especially communities where they have small schools. And this is something that I discussed last summer when I attended the first ever Islands Education Summit on Education. And we are working closely about how we roll out that commitment to ensure that all new head teachers come 2018 are indeed in possession of the headship qualification. Being a head teacher is a professionally and personally demanding role, and we have to ensure that all head teachers are supported to achieve the very best in that post, because of that, all the evidence shows us, is necessary for our children also to achieve their best. Presiding officer, we have already established the Scottish College for Educational Leadership, committed £4 million over the last 3 years to support master's level learning for teachers and created partnerships between universities and local authorities to improve teachers' experiences in the early part of their careers and provide high quality learning opportunities for experienced teachers. And we're also taking steps to require all new head teachers to be qualified before appointment, as I've outlined to Mr. Scott. So, Presiding Officer, we are in a good place, but the OECD's recommendations give a clear sense of how we can improve our system further, specifically to close the attainment gap and delivering excellence and equity in education for all. And these include the need to ensure an approach to improving equity based on what is known to work well, to strengthen the professional leadership of curriculum for excellence on a local basis, to simplify and clarify core guidance on curriculum for excellence, to further support strong relationships between schools and the wider communities they serve, and to develop an integrated framework for assessment and evaluation that encompasses all system levels. And the OECD report states that curriculum for excellence is at a watershed moment, and suggests that what is now needed is a bold approach that moves beyond system management in recognition of a new dynamic and energy generated nearer to teaching and learning. And I wholeheartedly agree with that. And that's why last week, after 3 months of extensive consultation with thousands of teachers, parents, educationalists and, crucially, children and young people, we launched the National Improvement Framework based on 4 key priorities for education: raising attainment, closing the attainment gap, improving health and wellbeing, and improving employability. And the framework is broad and comprehensive and sets out measures for school improvement, school leadership, supporting teachers and engaging parents. And I want to be very clear that our faith in the expertise and judgment of teachers is absolutely central in assessing pupil progress and the continuation of the Curriculum for Excellence assessment framework. And this approach will support an understanding of what works and therefore enable rapid and significant improvement. Teacher judgment lies at the heart of the system. From 2017, following pilots later this year, teacher judgment will be informed by a system of new national standardised assessments at primaries 1, 4, 7 and S3, which will help teachers and indeed parents make better, more objective and more consistent judgments about children's progress towards the different curriculum levels. And this teacher judgment data, underpinned by the new assessments, will be collected and published nationally each year to give us, for the very first time, a clear and consistent picture of how children and young people are progressing in their learning. And the National Improvement Framework creates a system which strikes the right balance between supporting the development of individual children and providing information and accountability about national and local performance. Teachers will be able to use the new assessments during the school year to help inform their judgments about and action to support individual children. Assessment must be used in a way that both informs and elicits timely action to improve outcomes for our children. For parents, it will mean clear, meaningful information on their child's progress, consistently presented no matter where they are in the country. And for teachers, local authorities and community planning partnerships, it means better data for identifying areas for improvement. And for the Scottish Government, it means we will have clear information to guide national policy. Crucially, it means everyone gets enough information early enough in children's education to pinpoint issues for individuals, schools, local areas and at a national level, and to address them with the right support at the right time. Presiding Officer, we can be rightly proud of the success our education system delivers for most of our children, as evaluated and reported on by a thorough and independent team of experts at the OECD. They have broadly endorsed our approach and given us 12 recommendations for action on where we can make further improvements. In particular, they concluded that we have a great opportunity to lead the world in developing an integrated assessment and evaluation framework. And this is what our new National Improvement Framework is designed to achieve. But we must not lose sight of the fact that success is elusive for some of our children, particularly those from deprived communities. And the gap in attainment is narrowing, but if we are to achieve our ambition of delivering a world-class education system for all of our children, then we must and will do more. This government has already started work on taking forward the OECD's report's recommendations with vigour and energy, and we're considering how to capitalise on this watershed moment identified for Curriculum for Excellence. We have launched the National Improvement Framework and are now focused very much on its implementation. And we have put education at the very heart of our agenda so that we can create a system focused on attainment and achievement, built around delivering equity and excellence, and crucially, aspiration and ambition. In other words, a world-class education system. Presiding Officer, I move the motion in my name.
Excellent. Thank you for finishing on time. Very tight for time today. Before I call on Ian Great, remind people who wish to speak in the debate to press the request to speak buttons, please. Call on Ian Great to speak to and move Amendment 15282.3 up to 10 minutes, please, Mr. Great.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I rise to move the amendment in my name. We all want Scotland to have a world-class education system, and our amendment is designed to strengthen the government motion in which there is little to object to, apart from the usual complacency and the complete absence of any action towards the end it purports to pursue. And no wonder, since there is no aspect of this government's record which moves us closer to a world-class education system, quite the reverse. After 9 years in power, they have achieved almost 4,500 fewer teachers in our schools, 140,000 fewer students in our colleges, bigger class sizes, though they promised smaller, student debt doubled, though they promised to abolish it, fewer level 3 and 4 apprenticeships than we had even 10 years ago, falling standards in literacy and numeracy, and the attainment gap between the rich and the rest as bad as ever. And in next year's budget, we see cuts in spending in real terms to higher education, to further education, and £500 million slashed from council budgets, the very councils who have to deliver, of course, our school education. Presiding Officer, you simply cannot claim to be taking education forward if you're clawing education funding back year on year. Of course, the government found now on the OECD review, as the Education Secretary did indeed today.
Dr. Alastair Allen.
I thank the member for giving way. He mentions the challenging time for local authority budgets. Has he reached a view yet as to where he would seek to find this budget, this money elsewhere in the budget, and what he would intend to cut to achieve that?
Ian Gray.
I simply say that to come here and say that you are supporting schools' education while taking £500 million from local government cannot be an honest approach to either politics or budgeting. The OECD report, actually says, and this is what it says in summary, is that we are above average, but that the world is catching up. It says, and I quote, that there are declining relative and absolute achievement levels on international data. It says that performance in literacy and numeracy is declining. And as I said last week, the government may be satisfied with the damnation of such faint praise, but it is not good enough for Scotland. For once, we did claim a world-leading education system in reality, not just aspiration. And our system has been a world leader over history, right back to the world's first Education Act of Parliament, a school in every parish in the 17th century. And in the 20th century, Scotland led the way in the creation of comprehensive schools serving the whole community. Breadth of curriculum, flexibility, equity and high attainment, those have always been the principles on which we have in the past led the world. And we have to nurture exactly those values anew in the 21st century now. That is why the pernicious attainment gap matters so much. The OECD report tells us that the gap is increasing as measured by literacy and numeracy. It acknowledges government initiatives to address that, but it also tells us that there is no strategy to be seen and warns of a danger of what it calls a scattergun approach. And it is right. Because firstly, a framework of any kind will not close the attainment gap, but at best will describe it. Although in our view, the dangers of the National Improvement Framework are wildly overstated in the Liberal Democrat amendment. But at best, this will give us information on which we must act or it will be of little value. When it comes to the Scottish Government's Attainment Challenge Fund, it is simply under-resourced and badly targeted. The First Minister re-announced bits of it again yesterday in another new and apparently random initiative. This attainment fund has been announced a couple of million pounds at a time, salami sliced into a plethora of projects, giving every appearance of being made up as they go along. In truth, it looks less like a focused strategy to close the attainment gap and more like a convenient instrument to fill the First Minister's media grid. Now, I've talked before about Cochrane Castle and St David's Schools in Johnson. Two schools, one building, same community, one gets attainment funding and the other does not. Last week, I was in East Ayrshire this time, in Kilmarnock, where children at one end of a street go to one school and the other end of the same street somewhere else. One will get attainment fund support in their school and the other will not. It makes no sense. Labour's Fair Start funding proposal would fix this. Indeed, East Ayrshire, where Kilmarnock, of course, is found, would receive over £2 million under our proposal instead of a few thousand in half a dozen primaries. My own constituency of East Lothian, the schools would share almost £900,000 instead of not one single penny. And nurseries would benefit too in our proposal because we know, and the OECD report tells us this again, that the gap is already established by age five. And it persists. At the weekend, we saw new figures regarding the attainment gap in senior school, because when it comes to three hires or more, the gap between those from poorer families and those from the richest grew yet again last year. The OECD report has nothing to say about that because it only reviewed primary 1 to S3. But today we've placed in spice an important submission it received from education expert Dr. Jim Scott on the impact of the new national 3, 4 and 5 exams. Dr. Scott showed last year that the new qualifications had narrowed the curriculum and reduced attainment. Ministers dismissed his concerns. Now, analysis of the second year of the new exams show those trends have continued. And those teachers the Education Secretary purported to respect so much made similar warnings too and have had to ballot for industrial action just to get a hearing. Dr. Scott shows that overall level 3 to 5 enrolment dropped by 17% compared to standard grades and attainment by 24%. In French and German, the drop is almost 50%. In Gaelic learners, it is 60%. And at level 5 credit level, as was, pass rates have dropped below 80% from the low 90s. I think once. Dr. Scott is very, very clear who is suffering here. He says, less able and middle-ranking learners appear to have differentially disappeared from both passes and enrolment. Ministers can't dismiss these figures. They amount to the loss of over 92,500 level 3 to 5 enrolments and 120,000 grade A to C passes at those levels. It is exactly the pupils at the wrong end of the attainment gap who are affected. This threatens the historical progress that the Education Secretary claimed as her own earlier. It's true, in 1965, when comprehensive education was introduced, 70% of pupils left school with no qualification at all. Reforms such as raising the leaving age and standard grades took that to less than 5%. But the truth is, we have never completely pushed comprehensive education through to senior years. And these figures show that Curriculum for Excellence has created an unintended narrowing of the curriculum there too. A world-class education system has to have more, not fewer, paths for young people, vocational as well as educational. It is time to make that reform. Reforming senior phase, encompassing colleges, universities, learning hubs and work experience as well as school. A reform which would properly reflect the recommendations of the Wood Report and learn from systems elsewhere, such as Germany and Finland. Built on a new parity of esteem between academic and vocational attainment and a new trust between sectors. It would require a proper reinvestment in colleges so they can re-establish their central position in a world-class system of education and training. Instead of reducing and narrowing the qualifications of thousands of young Scots, we should now seek ways to broaden and raise attainment, perhaps by creating a Scottish graduation certificate, reflecting exam results, vocational training, work experience, structured voluntary work, foundation apprenticeships, open university YAS courses, all of these things pulled together and properly resourced and recognised. Presiding Officer, the OECD report calls this time a watershed, and that is right. But to make the best use of that moment, we must have the honesty to admit and to face up to the problems in our education system. We must have the political will to provide the resources we need, the courage to push through curriculum for excellence to the senior phase, and then we can claim to be delivering a world-class education system. One thing is for sure, cuts and complacency will not do it.
Thanks so much. Now call on Liam MacArthur to speak to and move Amendment 15282.1. Mr MacArthur, up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. Aspiring to a world-class education system is absolutely where our sights should be set. This is not to denigrate the work of those working in our schools, colleges, universities and other parts of the education system. Many are pioneering, delivering exceptionally high-quality education to those in their care, and I pay tribute to them for their efforts. However, this is about how we build from that base, recognising the challenges set out in the OECD report, as Ian Gray said, and presented by an ever more globalised world where change is remorseless and rapid. Our young people need the skills to equip them not just to cope, but to thrive. That, in part, is why Curriculum for Excellence was developed, providing a depth, breadth and richness of learning that allows successful learners, confident individuals, responsible citizens and effective contributors to emerge. Yet, the evidence suggests that all too often, those from disadvantaged backgrounds are still not able to fulfil their potential. By the time they arrive in formal education, the gap for many has already opened up and is never successfully narrowed, far less closed. So ministers are right to have identified this as a priority, albeit 8 years into their office. The question is whether that approach is likely to be effective. Indeed, academics, as Ian Gray pointed out at Dundee University, warn that we're going in the wrong direction in certain respects. Clearly, closing the attainment gap, achieving greater equity of outcomes, is not something that can or should rest with our education system, critical though it undoubtedly is. That said, ministers present the NIF as a centrepiece of their strategy, and improving school leadership, teacher professionalism, parental involvement and performance information are all sensible and necessary components of any such strategy. Where I have a problem, and the Minister will not be surprised by this, is in the determination to reintroduce national testing in our primary schools. This move, whose sole advocates previously were the Scottish Conservatives, goes against the very ethos of Curriculum for Excellence. Assessment of pupils, of course, is at the heart of good teaching. Teachers do this on a daily basis, observing what happens in the classroom, marking pupils' work, gleaning information from the standardised tests that are already in place, and crucially, from having an in-depth knowledge of the young person as an individual. The Scottish education system has no shortage of such data, particularly at classroom and school level. The focus should be on making better use of this wealth of information, and national tests in literacy and numeracy simply won't provide a rounded evaluation of student learning. The risk of error is high, yet the information will inform government policy and decisions. Whether ministers believe they are sanctioning teaching to the test or league tables, these are likely to be the inevitable consequence of introducing national testing in primary schools. That is why teaching unions, individual teachers, parent-teacher councils and parents are all expressing concern. A one-size-fits-all approach that one education expert recently denounced as hopelessly blunt has also been described by teaching unions as a backward step, but not all that far backwards. Not so long ago, the former Education Secretary, Mr Russell, was describing the previous national testing regime and its league tables as, quote, Thatcherite. I recall the SNP hailed the scrapping of these Tory tests by the Labour Lib Dem executive. They even sought to claim credit for it. Of course, the Minister prayed and aid the recent OECD report, but even here there are warnings about the dangers of crude testing systems. Historically, in terms of educational reform, quote, outcomes-based learning is succeeded by high-stakes testing and a broad but inconsistently interpreted curriculum gives way to a prescriptive and more basic one. So, Deputy Presiding Officer, for all the assurances offered by the First Minister and the Education Secretary, Scottish Liberal Democrats remain unconvinced by the case for national tests, either to help close the attainment gap or to achieve a world-leading education system. This scepticism may partly be informed by what has happened from ministerial assurances on early learning and childcare. Under pressure from my party, the government promised to deliver free provision for 27% of two-year-olds from the poorest backgrounds by last summer. New figures show that only 7% currently benefit. Interestingly, in terms of the twin aim of raising attainment and closing the gap, the Royal Society appear to question whether indeed both are compatible. They suggest that, quote, universal approaches aimed at raising attainment may do so, but in a way that does not lead to greater equity. Increased parental involvement, for example, quote, could increase the gap. This point presumably is made to underscore what the Royal Society sees as the need for, quote, reprioritisation and redeployment of existing education expenditure. While ministers will point to their attainment fund and its recent extension to additional local authority areas, this still rather misses the point. 11 councils remain ineligible for funding, despite the fact that children in need are to be found in communities the length and breadth of Scotland. Ministers picking and choosing postcodes flies in the face of the reality of poverty and need. That's why Scottish Liberal Democrats, like Save the Children, believe in a pupil premium, linking funding to the individual child in need being the right approach, as happens south of the border, thanks to the previous coalition government. In addition, the attainment fund has to be seen in the context of Mr Swinney's brutal cut of £500 million in local authority budgets next year. Orkney Islands Council had been preparing for a cut of 1.6%. The reality is an eye-watering 4.3% cut, a settlement the convener described as wholly unacceptable. Given that education is around half of what councils do in budgetary terms, cuts are likely to fall most heavily on the education budget. It torpedoes the SNP claims about prioritising education and leaves councils to carry the can for the government's failure to put its money where its mouth is. Presiding officer, the ambition of creating a world-class education system is one I wholeheartedly support, so too the objective of enabling every child and young person to fulfil their potential. I question, though, whether the SNP's obsession with a return to national standardised testing, underachievement on early learning and cuts to council funding is a recipe for achieving those aims, and I move the amendment in my name.
Thanks very much. Now, Colin Mary Scanlon, up 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I would just like to start by saying that we are supporting the governance motion today, and the reason is that the government has actually acknowledged the recommendations of the OECD. They have accepted the OECD recommendations, acknowledged areas for improvement, and the determination to focus on excellence and equity, along with looking at not just the government, councils, teachers, etc. But what I want, and I think the government wants, is that no single child will be left behind. And the fact that they have stated the full potential, regardless of their family circumstances or background that they're born into. We fully accept that, and it's a nice change to look at a government motion that is constructive in looking at the facts. It will be no surprise to Ian Gray that we're not supporting the 50p tax rate, and it will be even less of a surprise to Liam MacArthur that we're not supporting his amendment given their opposition to testing. There is just one thing I'd like to seek clarity when the Minister sums up, and that is, I listened very carefully to what she said about information being published, but I'm not sure I'm entirely clear. Will every single local authority, will it be mandatory on each one to use the new assessment tests in the national framework? There just seems to be a bit of dubiety, and that would be helpful if we could look at that. But we very much welcome the fact that the government is reintroducing national assessments in primary and secondary schools. And as I said, the main issue is that no child is left behind. Some things that we would like to raise, in particular relation to literacy and numeracy, is the actual time that we welcome the fact that we're getting new teachers, but it's the time in the teacher training colleges that is allocated to literacy training. FYIs have been done over the years by Stuart Maxwell and others, and as little as 25 hours is being spent on literacy training in Scotland teacher training colleges, compared to an average of 90 in England. And I do think that whilst looking at the teacher training programme, it would be enormously helpful if the government could give that commitment to ensure that the teachers have the tools and the support to do the job that we expect them to do. We also welcome the investment of the £100 million for the attainment fund. But we want to make sure that that money is effectively spent. We would like to see the attainment fund money go directly to schools with high proportions of children from socially deprived backgrounds, so that individual pupils with poor attainment are identified and supported in order to improve their attainment levels. If we go to the OECD report, there's actually, despite the 180 pages, which I did look at, they've actually picked quite a few figures from the Audit Scotland report, which I've highlighted many times. And my main concern, Presiding Officer, is the transition from Primary 7 to S2. Attainment is not, it's not perfect, but it's not that bad at Primary 4 and Primary 7. But between Primary 7 and S2, something strange happens in Scottish education and attainment dips dramatically. The other thing is that Scottish adolescents are less likely to report liking school than students in many other countries, and liking also drops sharply in secondary school, according to the OECD. If I could just use a couple of figures. If we look, in order to close the gap, we need to increase the percentage of pupils performing well and performing very well at a level, and yet it's falling. If we just look, it's falling between 2011 and 2013, with Primary 7 going down by 6% of performing well in those 2 years, and in S2 it's gone down again. But the dramatic difference is in Primary 7, in 2013, 66% perform well, and in S2, it's 42%. That is too huge a reduction not to significantly look at. That's for numeracy. If we then look at reading, the fall is again on Primary 4, Primary 7 and S2, there's a fall in performing well between 2012 and 2014, but there's also that drastic fall between Primary 7 and S2. And I feel if the money's going to be spent wisely, we have to understand what happens, why there's such a deterioration in performance between P7 and S2, and why performance has deteriorated in the last couple of years. So while we all want pupils with low attainment to do better, we would all hope to close the attainment gap, but I don't think any of us want the standards from other deprived backgrounds to fall. So, I mean, people are performing less well from the least deprived backgrounds as well as the most deprived backgrounds. I appreciate that my time is almost up now, Presiding Officer, and I'll leave it there.
Thanks. We are extraordinarily tight for time today, so in order to protect the closing speakers in this debate, less would be more today. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Like you've already bit into my time, Presiding Officer. Like many of my colleagues here, fellow MSPs, I became involved in politics, and I've said this in other debates in the past in education, to try and make a difference in our community. And education is that cornerstone, it's a foundation for all these desires to change lives. But it's not easy, and that's why it's important for us to put in place a world-class education system which enables us as a nation to close the attainment gap, giving each child the best possible start in life and improving the life chances of our sons and daughters. The OECD report published last month highlights many positive areas in the Scottish education system, including our schools being highly inclusive and our levels of academic achievement being above international averages and distributed evenly. The report stated that there are clear upward trends in attainments and positive destinations. Over 9 in 10 and 10 of school leavers entered a positive follow-up destination in 2014, and nearly two-thirds of school leavers continue in education. There have been continuous upward trend in recent years. A key point I have taken from the report is that the OECD shares the Scottish Government's view that we have a great opportunity to lead the world in developing an integrated assessment and evaluation framework. I firmly believe the framework will play an important role in driving towards closing the attainment gap and continually improving Scottish education. I wholeheartedly share the First Minister's view that education, improving a child's life, is the most important thing we can do as a government. And while the OECD report is very positive and notes the many strengths of our education system, like the First Minister, it notes areas which need improvement when launching the new National Improvement Framework. The First Minister stated, despite the progress we are making, nobody can be comfortable living in a country where different levels of wealth create such a significant gap in attainment, and therefore the life chances of so many children. That's why the Scottish Government is taking concerted action now. I feel our point goes to the heart of this debate and what we're trying to do. Again, as highlighted in the report, children in Scotland are performing well. We still are producing the doctors and the scientists of the future, so we're getting a lot right. But we need to do more and quickly to support all the children in Scotland and raise attainment across the board. The National Improvement Framework allows the government, local authorities, teachers, and parents to quickly see where there are issues and more swiftly to address them. While teacher judgment will always be the heart of the system, we will see new nationalised standardised assessments for pupils in Primary 1, Primary 4, Primary 7 and S3. The Scottish Government believes that to be able to act swiftly, we need to understand what we are doing is working, and while some form of standardised assessment is already monitoring children's progress in other local authorities, these assessments haven't been conducted on a consistent basis. As a result, they currently lack the information on overall performance at both national and local level. So we need to identify where we need to improve and get on with doing the hard work. The OECD report makes 12 recommendations for action to improve Scotland's education system across areas such as leadership in schools, issues presented by existing data sources and complexities around curriculum for excellence. However, all the indications I can see is that we're already working towards improvements in these areas. Larry Flanagan, EIS General Secretary, said the OECD report paints a largely positive picture of Scottish education and the ongoing implementation of curriculum for excellence. These improvements, Presiding Officer, are being and will continue to achieve by the many initiatives set up and funded by the Scottish Government. It's currently investing £1.5 million per year in Read, Write and Count campaign to ensure that every Primary 1 to Primary 3 child has access to library books and education materials to improve early literacy and numeracy. Further investment will see over £1 million over 3 years from 2014 to 2017 in national and local numeracy hubs to raise standards and share best practice in teaching learning of math and numeracy levels. This is all on the back of the many achievements the Scottish Government has already had in education. The pupil-teachers ratio is the same as last year. However, not resting on this, on the 3rd of January this year, the Scottish Government announced that over £2 million funding has been made available to train extra 260 teachers next year. This increase of 60 primary and 200 secondary school teachers. Now, while I could go on all day, Presiding Officer, about the good work the Scottish Government has achieved at this stage in education, it's always important to look at where we've come from, how we got here, you know, how have we improved? And when you look at the fact that 40% of pupils from the 20% most deprived areas are getting at least one higher, that's up from 23% in 2007. A record percentage of young people are in work, education or training after leaving school. In 2006-2007, only 87% of school leavers were in positive destinations. The OECD 2012 PISA survey shows that we have halted the decline in Scotland's relative position in maths reading that began under Labour, and since 2009, under this government, we've seen improvements against other OECD countries. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, are we getting everything right in Scotland? No, it would be foolish to say so and to think so. But is this government committed to delivering a world-class education system? I would say yes. So as the Scottish Government has worked in partnership with other organisations and everyone else within education, I would say it's time for us, Presiding Officer, to all work together in this chamber like we did for Curriculum for Excellence and work together for the benefit of every single child in Scotland.
Many thanks. I call on John Pentland to be followed by Gordon MacDonald.
Presiding Officer, this Scottish Government debate today is here, I believe, not by choice, but is a reaction to the criticisms of their education policy. And it's easy to see why the SNP are under attack. Young people from wealthier families are twice as likely to go to university as those from poorer backgrounds. Over 6,000 Scottish children leave primary unable to read properly, and teacher numbers are now at the lowest level for 10 years. So finally, after nearly 9 years in power and after 9 years of Scottish Labour pressure, the SNP has admitted it needs to up its game. And if it gets back into power, it will make education its focus, unless, of course, it decides to have another referendum. So what do we get? We get a framework designed for soundbites that does not address the gap between the rich and poor, offers little by the way of real change, and for its big idea has the reintroduction of national testing. Of course, there was an outcry from the professionals, and rightly so, because they thought they had got rid of unhelpful league tables a decade ago. So now it's called standardised testing, and definitely not league tables, the First Minister insisted in the newspapers. But on January 6 this year, she tweeted that the percentage of pupils achieving literacy and numeracy curriculum levels will be published by school. So how does that work then? How will the SNP stop people turning published results into league tables? And perhaps the Cabinet Secretary can tell us that when she's summing up in her closing remarks. Scotland has, of course, dropped down the European educational league tables, but the latest OECD report does highlight some potentially good things that are happening alongside the bad. It says that the curriculum for excellence could be the basis of a good system, but it needs strengthening and more rigorous strategy with a stronger role for local authorities. Now, that might be a tad more difficult with councils getting hammered by SNP cuts. It also notes the poor literacy of primary and secondary students and the decline in relative and absolute achievement levels in mathematics. And since that report was published, we have heard that pupils from well-off backgrounds were 7 times more likely to get 3 A's at higher than those from poorer areas, while 14 local authorities had fewer than 5 poorer pupils achieve 3 A's. Enrolment in national 3-5 subjects has dropped by nearly 17% since the introduction of Curriculum for Excellence, meaning pupils are doing fewer subjects. Overall attainment in these subjects has dropped by 24%. Both enrolment and attainment in modern language is in a deep decline, to the point where some subjects may longer not be viable in Scotland. So clearly, the Scottish education system, which used to be held as a model for others, needs some TLC that it hasn't been getting recently, if it is to rise again. We need to make education the first priority, not just lip service, but investing in early years and education as our most important economic policy. We need to tackle the vicious circle of poverty and educational underperformance. And we need radical action to change the way we fund education so that the opportunity and the achievement are not dependent on wealth. And funding to tackle the attainment gap should be targeted, but not with a blunt instrument of grants to some schools and not to others. For it's a nonsense that one school can get funding while another next door gets nothing, even though both have pupils suffering from deprivation. And that's why Scottish Labour wants to see a Fair Start Fund, which gives an extra £1,000 for every child from a poor background in primary school and £300 in nursery school. That would ensure attainment funding based on need. And like the Labour government in Wales, we want to see that funding managed by head teachers, for they are the people best placed to decide which of the available measures will work best in their schools with their children. And this would be a permanent arrangement, not just a temporary sticking plaster. Presiding officer, if education is to be a national priority, then we should not be viciously cutting the budgets of those who provide education. Not only is it unfair, it's also very short-sighted. To neglect the education of our young people is to neglect the future of our economy. And for many reasons, education should be our priority, not just for lip service and sound bites. It should be for real action that makes that difference.
Thanks very much. I now call on Gordon MacDonald to be followed by Cara Hilton. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I apologise for about my voice, and hopefully it will last 6 minutes. Scotland has a fine history of achievement in education, starting with the establishment of church schools in the Middle Ages, five universities in Scotland by 1600, compared to only two south of the border, and the world's first National Education Act passed in 1696, providing for a school in every parish, a fixed salary for the teacher, and financial arrangements through property tax to pay for it. In 1872, the Education Act took control of the education system from the churches and handed it to local authorities, followed by the establishment of a single external examination system for Scotland in 1888. Scotland was at the forefront of innovation in education. Over a century later, international comparisons were introduced by the Organisation for Economic Cooperation and Development, with the Programme for International Student Assessment in the three areas of reading, mathematics and science. In 2012, 65 countries took part in the international comparison, and the Scottish results highlighted that levels of academic achievement are above international average in science, reading and close to average in maths. In science, Scotland has been above the OECD average in each PISA round since 2006. In reading, Scotland's performance in 2012 was above the OECD average, as it was in 2009, after falling under the last Labour Lib Dem executive between 2003 and 2006. Scotland's relative position compared to OECD countries and the rest of the UK has improved since 2009, with a greater number of countries performing significantly lower than Scotland and fewer countries performing similar to Scotland. In maths, the OECD found that Scotland's performance was similar to the average for all countries, and there was clear evidence that the decline in Scotland's performance between 2003 and 2006 has not continued. Again, Scotland's position in 2012 improved, with fewer countries outperforming and greater numbers performing significantly below Scotland. That was the position in 2012, and we await the 2015 PISA scores that are due out later this year. However, the report Improving Schools in Scotland, an OECD perspective, published in December, gave us an indication of progress. It stated in its overview that learners are enthusiastic and motivated, teachers are engaged and professional, and system leaders are highly committed. As many as 9 in 10 inspections report improvements in confidence, engagement, staying on in school, and national qualifications over the recent past, broadly coincident with the implementation of curriculum for excellence in schools. The report has highlighted that there was much to be positive about, and that there was a high level of social inclusion, and that a large majority, 9 out of 10 students, who feel positive about their school and teachers. Now, part of the reason for students feeling positive about their school may be that the number of pupils reported as being in schools of good or satisfactory condition has increased from 61% in April 2007, just prior to the first SNP government taking office, to 85% in April 2015. Or that the latest national performance report shows 90% of schools were graded satisfactorily or better, including 69% that were graded as good, very good, or excellent. As a result, students across Scotland achieve a record 156,000 higher passes in 2015, with advanced higher passes having increased by 4% to record levels. Despite progress since 2007, that doesn't mean that there are no challenges facing Scottish education. The First Minister outlined last autumn at the Western Hills Education Centre in my constituency her twin priorities of improving attainment for all children and tackling the attainment gap between children in deprived and better off areas. The £100 million Attainment Scotland Fund to improve literacy, numeracy and health and wellbeing for primary schools was extended to a further 57 schools, including three in my constituency, taking the total number of primary schools benefiting from the fund to more than 300. The December 2015 OECD report found that Scotland has been among the OECD countries with the most equal scores for mathematics achievements among 15-year-olds, and the spread of socio-economic background in Scotland is narrower than across the OECD as a whole. It continued, a third of disadvantaged students were identified as resilient in 2012, meaning those from the bottom quarter in status terms who performed in the top quarter of international performance. This is higher than the OECD average of 25%. EIS General Secretary Larry Flanagan said, it confirms previous data that indicates that Scottish schools and levels of pupil attainment compare well both internationally and with other countries within the UK, and the report painted a largely positive picture of Scottish education.
Draw to a close, please.
As the OECD recognised, Curriculum for Excellence has the ability to deliver a world-class education system for all, putting Scotland once again at the forefront of innovation in education.
Thanks very much. Now call on Cara Hilton to be followed by Willie Coffey. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. We all want a Scotland to have an education system to be proud of, a Scotland in which every child in every community can achieve their true potential at school and in life. There's nothing more important than ensuring that every child gets a fair start. So today, while the SNP Government are keen to highlight the positive aspects of the OECD report, the fact remains that the achievement gap between the most and least deprived children is continuing to grow under the SNP's watch, and that the SNP solutions so far fall well behind what is needed to end the inequality in our classrooms. We must use the powers of this Parliament to change people's lives, to reshape our country and to transform life chances so that opportunity and success at school, at work and in life are determined by hard work, effort and talent, not by who your parents are or how much they earn. And Ian Gray talked earlier about the attainment fund set up by the Scottish Government. In my Dunfermline constituency, there are two schools benefiting from this fund. Yet in every nursery school, in every primary school and in every secondary school in my constituency, there are children and families from poorer backgrounds who need extra support. One of the schools receiving attainment fund support in my constituency is Inzivar in Oakley, and it shares a campus with Holy Name Primary. The children use the same gym hall, the same assembly hall, the same library, the same playground, yet Holy Name gets no funding at all to close the attainment gap. And that's why today our amendment is calling once again for us to be more ambitious and to use the powers coming to Holyrood to invest more in the children currently being left behind and ensure that every child from a poorer family gets a fair start in life through a fair start fund based on need, not on what school they go to, making support available not just to schools but to nurseries too. And across Scotland, we are asking people to take a fresh look at Scottish Labour, so maybe the Cabinet Secretary too will take a fresh look at our plans to give every child a fair start at school and nursery. The Liberal Democrat amendment today talks about the issue of preschool provision and its importance in improving outcomes for children from more deprived backgrounds. And this is important too because we know that the attainment gap begins well before children start school. By three years old, 15% of children already have speech and language difficulties, with children from the most deprived areas more than twice as likely to have issues. By the same age, children from deprived backgrounds are already 9 months behind in the average development and readiness for school. And in starting school, there is already a 14% gap between the most and least advantaged children and a 16% gap in vocabulary. And all the evidence shows that children who start school with these early development difficulties are much more likely to fall behind other children in their attainment at every stage of the education system. It's therefore really vital that we get it right for every child in the early years. Yet in December 2015, as Liam MacArthur highlighted, just 7.3% of two-year-olds were registered for early learning and childcare, well short of the 27% promised. And there's real evidence that across Scotland, many children are not only missing out on the free childcare for two-year-olds, but they're also missing out on free places available for three- and four-year-olds too. The SNP are going into the election in May, promising parents a doubling of preschool hours, yet are still unable to deliver the hours already in place, never mind say how the 30 hours are going to be delivered or paid for. Research by the Fair Funding for Kids campaign found that as many as one in five children are missing out on their free places, and doubling the free hours could make the situation worse, reducing the number of spaces in council nurseries by as much as 40%. This sort of falls into line with what the Commission on Childcare Reform said earlier this summer, when they found that many parents across Scotland are unable to access the 600 hours, and they concluded that the focus on delivering this policy was at the expense of broader childcare provision. And given that there's only 15% of councils in Scotland with enough capacity to meet the childcare needs of working parents, parents across Scotland want to know who want to work and make a better life for their families needs much more than a promise of free hours. And I think we need a radical overhaul of childcare so that it's affordable, flexible and available for children of all ages where and when parents need it. In the briefing for today's debate, Save the Children highlight their excellent Read On, Get On campaign, and this has got Scottish Labour's support. I think it's unacceptable that Scotland's poorest children are starting school already struggling with language and literacy, and it's unacceptable that these same children, many of them, are leaving school unable to read well. So within the national framework, I think there's got to be a lot more emphasis on the importance of preschool intervention to close the language gap and ensure that every single child has got the support they need to meet the key milestones in early language and literacy before they start primary school. We can't, however, look at education policy in isolation, and members across the chamber already have referred to the budget cuts that are going to be hitting our councils. These certainly won't help in our mission to close the gap. Cuts to our council budgets are cuts that will hit our schools, our early years services and measures that have been taken to close the gap. In Fife, for example, where the council already had a £20 million budget shortfall to make up in the coming financial year, the additional cuts announced in the budget before Christmas mean the council will need to make a further £17 million of savings. In this chamber, we regularly hear attacks on the Tory austerity agenda, and quite right too. But yet now, the communities I represent in Fife and communities right across Scotland, the austerity agenda has not just been imposed by Tories in Holyrood, it's been imposed here by Holyrood too. And our children and young people, they shouldn't be paying the price of cuts, and they certainly shouldn't be paying the price of austerity and cuts to our schools, cuts to our colleges, cuts to our universities, cuts to our youth work services. This is not the route to educational success. So I can see I'm running out of time. If the government is serious about making our education system world-class once again, then action is needed now to protect our education budgets and to give our councils a fair deal.
Thanks so much. And I now call on Willie Coffey to be followed by Stuart Stevenson, up to 6 minutes.
Thanks very much, Presiding Officer. The OECD report, for most of us who aren't experts, can be a challenging read at times, but it's a very positive report, both about Scotland's achievements to date and the potential for Scotland to be a world leader in education. It describes the Curriculum for Excellence as being a watershed moment, with 10 solid years of patient work in place and now presenting us with the opportunity to move the agenda on to a new phase, to move beyond what it calls system management and into a new dynamic nearer to teaching and learning. It says we need to strengthen what it calls this middle area involving networking and collaboration. Now, I take that to mean we need to see more engagement amongst our professionals up and down the country and amongst our education authorities too, so that we can truly bring about the kinds of improvements we need that will begin to close the various gaps that concern us. Principally attainment, of course, but hopefully also to do something about opportunity gaps that exist within our system. The report acknowledges a number of improvements and gives particular mention to Scotland's above international averages in science and reading, that our achievement levels are spread fairly equally, that a high number of Scottish students from our bottom socioeconomic status groups perform in the top quarter of international achievers, that our schools are inclusive and there are clear upward trends in attainment, and 90% of our school leavers entered a positive destination, which has been continuously improving in recent years. Improvements are also noted in relation to pupils' positive attitudes towards their schools and teachers, and a welcome drop in negative behaviour involving things like smoking, alcohol abuse and general disruptive behaviour, all on the decline, thankfully. In terms of current performance, there is evidence of an improving picture in a number of areas. Higher numbers of our young people from disadvantaged backgrounds are getting better qualifications. Almost double the numbers are getting at least one higher when you compare to 2007. We have record exam pass results with passes in hires and advanced hires both on the up, and we have the highest numbers of youngsters ever applying to go to university, with a huge 50% increase coming from youngsters from disadvantaged backgrounds. More needs to be done, of course, but there is good progress being made. What then lies beyond this watershed that the report says we are currently at? At the heart of it, according to my understanding anyway, is how we assess and how we evaluate and how that leads us towards improvement. The report applauds our teachers for their current ingenuity in devising varieties of methods to collect information, but then goes on to say that there is some concern that insufficient use is made of that assessment information to support children's learning progress and curriculum development, and that too many teachers are still unclear about what should be assessed in terms of experiences and outcomes, all of which serve to blur the connection between assessment and improvement. In other words, if we are all measuring things differently, we have little chance of concluding anything meaningful from it, and we have less ability to claim that improvements are evident across the system. We need a robust and consistent evidence base to help us with our assessment methods, and the OECD paper supports the view that the National Improvement Framework has the potential to deliver this for us. Standardised assessment gives us the chance to move forward from this watershed, to provide that clearer and more concise narrative within the assessment process, and to begin this important next phase in the life of Curriculum for Excellence. Keir Bloomer's comments that measurement systems in themselves don't raise standards or close gaps, that's spot on, I think. But they should provide us with some consistency in the assessment process, from which we can hopefully make informed judgments that are more reliable than anything we currently have. The First Minister has made it clear that using new standardised assessments in primaries 1, 4 and 7 and in S3 will help our teachers to form those crucial judgments about the progress that our children are making, and to provide the required support when it's most needed. Offering parents access to this information too means that we can extend the scope of interest to the wider family and the crucial role that this plays in the education of our children. As usual, we will rely heavily on the good services we obtain from Education Scotland to drive this process forward. Education Scotland has been at the vanguard of Curriculum for Excellence for many years, and I know many colleagues in the organisation there are totally committed to improving excellence in education. Presiding Officer, I want to just add a little note of caution to the debate and winding up my contribution. As Keir Bloomer said, systems and processes don't in themselves do very much. They act as enablers to help us to get things right, and we must still work hard to improve anything. Closing the attainment gap between our wealthiest and poorest communities in the next decade will be an amazing achievement if we manage this, but an opportunity gap still exists. Members might recall the story last year about the young student from Postle Park who achieved all the necessary qualifications for medical school at four of Scotland's finest universities but was still refused entry. Attainment and opportunity are two very different things, and I'm glad to see that our universities are aware of this and doing something about it through their REACH initiative. Closing the attainment gap will surely help many more talented young people from disadvantaged backgrounds. We have a duty, Presiding Officer, to make this possible for all our young people in Scotland, and I'm hopeful that this new framework will take us closer to this goal than we've ever been before. Thank you.
Many thanks. Now calling Stuart Stevenson to be followed by Joanne Lamont.
Presiding Officer, we will continue to be challenged as individuals and as an educational system by the youngsters of today. Most youngsters don't carry a pen or a pencil, very different from my time as a youngster. but most have an intelligent phone and are more adept at operating the on-screen keyboard on that than they are perhaps at using a pen or pencil. The modern world is very different from the world in which my grandfather started teaching 135 years ago, and it will keep changing. In 1881, my grandfather was a pupil teacher in Bowness. By 1890, he was a school teacher in Eyemouth, and in 1900, he had his own school in a rural location in the Black Isle. And the school photograph for that year shows the majority of pupils at the school were barefoot. They depended at lunchtime on my grandmother preparing soup as the school lunch, which was made from the vegetables that the pupils themselves took to school. And when my grandfather retired from teaching in 1926, he had achieved the lofty heights of the Fellowship of the Educational Institute of Scotland. A very different experience from today's teachers, a very different experience from the pupils of today in my grandfather's school. Today, other members of my family, my niece Morag, teaches in England. She is taught in both the public sector and the private sector. She looks with some envy at aspects of the Scottish system. My nephew, Jamie, is based in Denmark, married to a Dane, and with a Danish family, a very different educational system there as well. One not without its difficulties. The government chose, because of a dispute with the unions in Denmark, to lock all the teachers out for over a period of month. My nephew didn't much enjoy that. And perhaps as an illustration of how things change, when I was a student studying mathematics in the 1960s, I was in my intermediate honours year, and one of my landlady's, Diggs landlady's, friend's 12-year-old pupil came to get help with his maths. He was studying topology at school. We at university had yet to reach that subject. So we can't expect the past to be repeated in the future. And, of course, we shouldn't also imagine, although the report is, of course, about the formal education system, that all education takes place in school. It's important that parents and relatives are equally equipped to answer the very intelligent questions that our youngsters will inevitably come up with. I did a little experiment with my 4-year-old goddaughter a couple of months ago. She was asking about a rock crystal that we had, and I explained crystals by showing her salt crystals, dissolving them in water, and then evaporating the water on the stove. Fascinated by that she was, and we had a discussion. Hopefully that's typical of the kind of discussions that are going on across Scotland. Now, one of the things I was very much taken by in the OECD report that is particular to my parliamentary constituency, it was the comment that Scotland enjoys one of the smallest proportions of low performers among its immigrant students. Now, that's important to me because of the 4 secondary schools that I have in my constituency. On average, they have 20 different languages in the schools. At Peterhead, it has just become 28 with the addition of Hungarian. Now, it's not new in the northeast of Scotland that we interact with the rest of the world and language is an issue. As long ago as 1853, the Post Office Directory shows there were 3 foreign consulates in Peterhead. Now, of course, that is both a challenge and an opportunity. And in some of our schools, I've seen that the immigrants bringing their own language to the school have very successfully passed on aspects of culture and, more critically, language to the local population, who in return have taught those who've come to our community how to speak Doric. And only a minority of the people here this afternoon are likely to be able to do that. Education is and will always remain a work in progress, and informal learning and having the opportunities for that is important. I looked too at what the OECD report said about some international examples, referring to the Ontario Teacher Leadership and Learning Programme and the Alberta Initiative for School Improvement. Both fascinating insights into what can be done elsewhere, because I think we've got to accept there is no single answer. What actually is most important is that those who are engaged in education are committed to picking up new ideas, trying them out. There is no single idea. If there was a magic bullet, somebody would have found it and we'd be applying it. But equally, we've got to be slightly conscious of the Hawthorne effect, which comes from a factory in the United States in the 1920s to the early 30s, where the mere intervention of change can deliver short-term value. But I think there's excellent work in the OECD report that leads us to where we are. Now, I continue to say, Minister, the Trachtenberg system would be good. And, of course, speaking from the lofty heights of my many years, I think it would be worth looking at the experience of older people, making sure that we get them into schools, imparting their knowledge and experience to our students. We've got to be adaptable. This report is a good interim report. There's more to do. I'm confident the government is both willing, able and actually doing it. Presiding officer.
Thanks so much. Now call on Joanne Lamont to be followed by Stuart McMillan.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I declare an interest as a member of the EIS? I was a teacher for 20 years and probably at my heart still am. I always welcome the opportunity to be involved in a debate in education, recognising its role in creating a stronger, fairer economy, in tackling inequality, releasing potential and offering important means out of poverty. And I'm sad to say, I think too often debates in education become a kind of a theoretical argument, an exchange of figures that can prove almost anything. I think there's been an element of that today. I think that we are at our best when our debates in education are rooted in the real world, in the real life experience of people across Scotland. And I would urge the Scottish Government to reflect on Jim Scott's report rather than trying to find a way of explaining it away, because there are important issues there that are being highlighted. As a young teacher, I taught non-certificate classes before standard grade came in. And if you were in a non-certificate class, it basically meant there was no course, there were no resources, and there was no recognition of the effort you made as a young person. And with standard grades, there came a recognition that every child was entitled to have a course and resources put behind them, and they could show what they had achieved. And I would be very concerned in the current circumstances if we're moving away from that. And I would urge the Scottish Government to look at that again. And on the question of testing, I think there's an argument to be had about the benefits and merits of testing. But my concern is that the proposal will simply describe the situation without then action to address what that situation tells us. We know that there are key issues in relation to poverty, disadvantage, in relation to attainment. And if all we're doing through testing is reflecting that, then frankly, we're wasting our time. The Scottish Government has announced its attainment grant fund, but I would contend that any drive to close the attainment gap must be mainstreamed into our education policy. It's not an add-on, it's not an extra, but it should inform all of our policy and budget choices. And again, I would urge the Scottish Government to have the confidence to look at the choices it has made in this context. And against the test of closing the attainment gap, are the things you're spending money on in education going to make that better or worse? And I'll give you as one example. I would argue strongly that if the attainment gap is at the heart of education policy, the further education sector would not have suffered the ruthless cuts and attacks that it's experienced from this Scottish Government. For early intervention, for example, is even more effective where parents can be supported. And what better than a parent taking a second chance at education or securing skills into work offers that the college sector in the past have given and are less likely to be there now. And of course, I would say that Education Scotland is relatively good at supporting and developing young people who are settled with supportive families and with families who can step in and fill the gaps left by cuts in school funds. But I would also congratulate all those in schools who support young people with greater challenges, perhaps because of barriers created by additional needs, not least the parents and young people themselves, or in school communities facing families with real problems within their own lives. For we know that schools cannot just be buildings, teachers and jotters, but need to understand the needs and pressures on particular young people and how current spending decisions have an impact on them. Now, we should, of course, be clear there are pressures on young people from all kinds of families, not just those living in poverty. Bereavement, bullying, neglect and abuse are no respecter of person or class. They can happen to any child, and it's essential that schools are alive to the danger that young people faced by these pressures will simply fall out of the system. But we do know that poverty and disadvantage are key determinants in attainment and require a rigorous approach, not short-term initiatives which are not sustained. And I would highlight in particular my view that the Scottish Government must review its approach to the funding of local government if it's serious about its commitment on attainment. Not just the cuts in general, but the lack of rigour in ensuring that education spending follows need. If a young person is vulnerable to falling out of the school system, attending less, achieving less, becoming less engaged, action needs to be speedy, proactive, or it becomes too late, and we live with the consequences of that for a generation. And that's why I would urge his Cabinet Secretary to ensure that she is enabling schools to fund properly the attendance officers, the support staff, the learning support, the behaviour support, the classroom assistants, the personal assistants, the educational psychologists, home link staff, admin staff that allows a school to reach out to children who are vulnerable and unsupported. These are not a bonus or an added extra. They are critical in holding and supporting young people to come to school in order that they benefit from the assessment and learning that is on offer. And in spotting problems, in addressing challenges for families, in addressing additional needs, there is an opportunity to give these young people the chance to learn. If these are stripped out, there are massive consequences, and all the evidence is that is exactly what is happening. You know, Scottish education through the years prided itself in developing inquiring minds, open to new ideas, willing to scrutinise and test ideas and views that were perhaps the established view. That is the challenge for the Scottish Government now. Don't close down the debate in education. Don't simply defend the choices that you have made. Open this debate up, and we will be with you if we are going to ensure that we resource local government and communities properly so that we can genuinely address the attainment gap and get the potential for our young people that education offers.
Thanks so much. Regret to now have to reduce the remaining open debate speakers to 5 minutes. Mr McMillan, Stuart McMillan, to be followed by Alison Johnson. Up to 5 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. In listening to Stuart Stevenson's contribution, two things actually struck me. First of all, when we spoke about children and the questioning from children, I've got two daughters, and I'm sure certainly what I'm about to say the Cabinet Secretary will agree with as well, but I've got two daughters, and certainly some of the questions that are coming from my daughters, certainly in the last few months, have been particularly challenging, not so much in the scientific element, but certainly in terms of other areas. But the second point is that in terms of the informal learning that Stuart Stevenson was talking about, a number of years ago, I went to Sweden for a visit to visit some friends. And a person was there was asked to go in to speak to two classes in a high school. And that was, so it was very much an informal learning, but in a formal setting. I was asked to go in because the kids were learning English, but they were used to either learning English by hearing an English accent or English from an American accent. So it was to actually hear English from someone with a different accent. It was a fascinating experience and something I genuinely thought was a great thing to do. But I certainly took something from it as well. But certainly, as I said, it was something that came to mind when Stuart Stevenson was speaking. But I certainly was encouraged by the recent OECD review on Scottish education. And as others have mentioned, this report paints a largely positive picture of Scottish education and the ongoing implementation of Curriculum for Excellence. We do share the view that, of the OECD that we have a great opportunity to lead the world in developing an integrated assessment and evaluation framework. We firmly believe that the framework will play an important role in driving forward to close the attainment gap and continually improve Scottish education. And we do want to be able to say, and I'm sure everyone in this chamber want to be able to say with confidence and also with evidence, that there is no better place in the world to be educated than here in Scotland. We want to know that this claim holds true for all young people, regardless of their background or their circumstances. Scotland must seize the opportunity to be a world leader in assessing and driving forward educational progress for all children. It's no secret that the last 8 years have been tough. The recession and the deep public spending cuts from Westminster, which followed that, have created pressures for the Scottish Government, for local government and for many families. But the fact remains that education in Scotland has made progress. In every part of the country, I only have 5 minutes, I'm sorry. In every part of the country, Scotland has good schools, good teachers, and our young people are good learners. Standards have risen and are continuing to rise. We are committed to protecting teacher numbers, and all 32 local authorities have committed to protecting teacher numbers and will share in £51 million in investment from the Scottish Government to support this. And as we've already heard, the announcement on the 3rd of January, there has been an additional £2 million of investment by the Scottish Government to train an extra 260 teachers next year, 60 teachers in primary education and 200 in secondary education. Presiding officer, a child born today in one of our most deprived communities should, by the time he or she leaves school, have the same chance of going to university as a child born in one of our most affluent communities. And we certainly want to close the attainment gap completely. This won't happen overnight, but this is more than just an economic and a social challenge for all of us. It's a moral challenge. And last week, the First Minister launched the National Improvement Framework for Education, which will help to eliminate the attainment gap between the least and most deprived children. The framework has been developed in consultation with teachers, parents and local authorities. And when you consider the range of people who are actually supporting this framework, then I think it's there for all to see that this actually will be a positive development for Scotland and for our education system. This framework will see new and better information gathered throughout primary and secondary, well, early secondary school years, to support individual children's progress and to identify where improvement is needed. And also, this will be backed by the Attainment Scotland Fund of more than £100 million over 4 years to drive forward improvements on additional educational outcomes in Scotland. Presiding officer, we will defend the achievements not just of the government, but of students, pupils and teachers across our country. But we will also be open to where we need to do better, because in every single walk of life, we can always improve. We always have to strive to be better, to develop things better. Presiding officer, sustained investment in learning from early years to further and higher education will continue to drive up attainment and mobilise all of Scotland's talents. Thank you very much.
Thank you, and thank you for your brevity. Now, Colin Alison Johnson, to be followed by Colin Beattie. Up to 5 minutes, please.
Thank you, presiding officer. I thank the government for bringing this debate today, as it's important that Parliament has the opportunity to scrutinise our education system and propose changes to parts of that system, to look at what's working well and also what could be improved upon, as the motion acknowledges. And there is much in the motion to welcome: the more holistic approach of the curriculum for excellence, the stress on trust and teachers' professional judgment, and a recognition that reducing energy-sapping, frustrating and time-wasting bureaucracy is essential. The motion tells us that the OECD report suggests that the National Improvement Framework has the potential to provide a robust evidence base and that it will be a key means of driving work to close the attainment gap. But key education partners like the EIS tell us that, yes, good evidence is part of the equation and that assessment is absolutely central to teaching and learning, but they confirm that we already have this evidence and we know that assessment is ongoing, and not only in literacy and numeracy. Teachers assess pupils daily and use this knowledge to help our young people progress. The EIS doesn't agree that standardised tests are the key to improving education. 30 out of 32 local authorities use standardised tests, yet the attainment gap persists. And perhaps in closing, the Cabinet Secretary can confirm whether the tests currently taking place will be replaced or will there simply be more. We all appreciate that there are within school, between school and beyond school, particularly home and family drivers, which can help close the attainment gap. And it's really important that we take the broadest approach to attainment, as well as ensuring we're making progress where formal attainment is poor. And I appreciate that the government knows that good evidence is only one part of the equation. And I would hope that at the end of this debate, Parliament is clear about how the government intends to avoid unintended consequences like national league tables. The EIS, in their response to the consultation on the National Improvement Framework, ask that protections are put in place to ensure that this doesn't happen. And I would be grateful if the Cabinet Secretary could address this. I'd also like to understand what the government will do with this evidence that it hasn't been able to do so far or isn't able to do currently. But I would ask the government to focus instead on areas like teacher recruitment, class sizes, which are clearly linked, and teacher workloads. And a greater focus too on the quality of early years childcare. I'm very concerned, as are parents and the Scottish Children's Services Coalition, about the fall in numbers of additional support needs teachers. Colleagues have raised this too today. Now, I recognise that the government is working to fill vacancies, not just in ESN, but has the government considered making support for learning a promoted post? The Cabinet Secretary is aware of a marked increase in children with additional support needs since 2010 to a figure of 153,190 pupils. So currently, 22.5% of children in Scotland schools have additional support needs. Now, local authorities are facing budget cuts on a staggering scale, but the costs from not ensuring that adequate provision for those young people with additional support needs is in place will outweigh any savings. Exclusions will increase, and positive destinations will be harder to secure for these young people. Now, these positive destinations include our further education colleges. And I recently spent a very cold Friday afternoon outside the Scottish Funding Council's offices with members of the EIS Further Education Lecturers Association. And the cold was only matched by their passion. Passion for the invaluable work they do, and passion for an equitable and secure future for those working in this sector, for equal pay. Now, our colleges have as much to offer as our universities, and we should treat them and those who study and work in them equitably. We must ensure that more financial assistance beyond fees is available for those students who require it. Many potential students can't afford to feed, clothes and house themselves without a wage. Grant funding is essential. We don't want young people to opt out of further or higher education through necessity, not choice. I too would like to thank all those working with the young people on whom today's debate has concentrated. But education should be encouraged and enabled from the cradle to the grave, because parents, grandparents and carers are children's first educators and clearly have a central role in any education system. So we have to be absolutely clear that austerity shouldn't impact on those who study in local community centres across the land, enabling them better to bring up and educate their own children. Our young pupils,
would you draw to a close, please?
Indeed. Our young people's future choices are impacted by their time at school, but that isn't the whole story. I'd like to understand if every child in nursery education in Scotland will have access to a nursery teacher, because as we've heard throughout this debate today, inequalities in literacy often begin in early childhood, and increasing teacher numbers would help address that equal access to early years education. Thank you.
Thanks so much. Now call on Colin Beattie, after which we move to the closing speeches. Up to 5 minutes, please, Mr Beattie.
Presiding Officer, the independent review, Improving Schools in Scotland, an OECD Perspective, published last month by the OECD, clearly shows to me that the Scottish Government is on the right lines with the progress it's made to date in our education system. Further, the review confirms that the steps proposed going forward are without doubt the correct ones, although there can be no resting on our laurels. The aim for Scotland's education system is clear. We aim to have an exceptional and fair system where every young person in this country has the tools they need to achieve their potential, regardless of background. And I hope that everyone would agree that is a worthy role. In this regard, the OECD review highlighted many positive developments in Scottish education, including levels of academic achievement being above international averages and distributed evenly, the high inclusion rate of Scottish schools, a clear upward trend in attainment and positive destinations, positive attitudes in schools and among pupils, noticeable drops in alcohol consumption and smoking among children and young people. The report also highlighted that over 9 out of 10 school leavers entered a positive destination in 2014, with nearly two-thirds of school leavers continuing on in education. And these are figures that we can be proud of, especially when we put them in the context of the years before this government came into power. For example, the statistics show that 40% of pupils from the 20% most deprived areas are getting at least one higher. And this is a substantial increase from the 23% in 2007. Meanwhile, 91.7% of young people are in work, education or training after leaving school. And this compares favourably to 2006-07, when only 87% of school leavers were in positive destinations. And very encouragingly, we've also seen a 50% increase in university applications from 18-year-olds from the most deprived areas since 2006. Of course, we must ensure that equity and excellence in our education system go hand in hand, and the OECD review highlights some of the improvements in this context, including that academic achievement is above international averages in science and reading and near average in maths, while the most recent studies show
that we've halted the decline in maths and reading seen in Scotland's relative position prior to 2006. Performances in literacy, maths and numeracy can be improved further, and we're taking ambitious steps to continue the work done to date, and these include investing £1.5 million per year in the Read, Write, Count campaign to ensure every P1 to P3 child has access to a library of books and educational materials to improve early literacy and numeracy. The introduction of a draft national improvement framework, which will focus on improving outcomes for children by providing better evidence on progress in literacy and numeracy. Focusing Education Scotland inspections on raising attainment in literacy and numeracy. Each school will be expected to demonstrate a very clear strategy for raising attainment in literacy. Investing £1 million over 3 years from 2014 to 2017 in national and local numeracy hubs to raise standards and share best practice in the teaching and learning of maths and numeracy at all levels. Launching the Making Maths Count programme to drive up maths and numeracy attainment in primary and secondary schools by championing the importance of maths. We also need to ensure we have the right number of highly trained teachers to preserve our educational standards and teacher-pupil ratios. And we worked with local authorities last year to maintain teacher numbers, and that will be done again this year with a further £51 million in funding. And these steps ensured that the pupil-teacher ratio stayed constant at 13.7 over 2014-15, despite an increase in the number of pupils in that time. As recently as January 3rd, the Scottish Government reiterated their commitment to teacher numbers with the announcement that over £2 million funding is being made available to train an extra 260 teachers next year, an increase of 60 primary and 200 secondary student teacher places, which will bring the total intake to 3,490, a rise for the fifth year in a row. The OECD review also endorsed the Government's introduction of a national improvement framework that features standardised assessment at its heart. At present, there is a significant lack of information about overall performance at both national and local levels. A national framework will ensure we can gather the right evidence about children's progress to show that everything local authorities, schools, teachers, parents and children and young people themselves are doing to raise standards is working.
You need to bring your remarks to a close.
There can be no doubt that Scotland's education system will always face challenges, but it's clear to me that the steps being taken so far and are continuing to be taken, including the national framework, the £100 million attainment fund, the recent announcement of the £1.5 million innovation fund that will identify and fund projects to improve literacy, numeracy, health and wellbeing for children adversely impacted by deprivation, can truly give Scotland the potential to become a world leader in education.
Thank you. I now call on Liam MacArthur. Up to 6 minutes, Mr MacArthur.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I think it's been a very useful debate with, I think, some very considered speeches across the chamber. I think I'm particularly grateful to Joanne Lamont for her contribution. I didn't necessarily agree with all of it, but I think she usefully reminded us why this debate matters. I think the ability of education to unlock the potential of individuals, yes, but of communities and of Scotland as a country. I think the shared objective of creating a world-class education system was again something that was very evident in all of the speeches that were made. The OECD report, I think, probably wins the prize for most name checks. Colin Beattie, Willie Coffey and Gordon MacDonald, I think legitimately pointed to the elements of that report that suggest things that are performing well within the Scottish education system and indeed trends that are moving in the right direction, although I think there was a bit of a tendency to adopt a bit of a year zero approach in terms of those positive trends. Likewise, I think Mary Scanlon, Ian Gray and others were right to highlight some of the areas where there are cause for concern, whether that's in terms of the progress that other competitor countries are making comparative to ourselves, but in specific areas such as literacy and numeracy as well. In my earlier contribution, I made a number of criticisms of the Scottish Government. I think those were intended to be constructive. I think that in the context of the constructive approach that we as a party have taken in a range of areas, not just in relation to education, but it stems from, I think, a recognition of the crucial importance of the early years in both shaping and determining later attainment. I thought Cara Hilton made some very salient points there in relation to the difference in speech and language difficulties presented by those from more deprived backgrounds when they arrive informal education. It's why we prioritised investment in early learning and childcare, particularly for those from most disadvantaged backgrounds. We refuse to accept ministers' assertions that this required the powers of independence to achieve. We press for more ambitious targets, and we welcome the agreement to move from short of 2% to 27% of two-year-olds from such backgrounds. And we're disappointed that that figure is currently only just above 7%. I'd be interested to know how that gap is to be bridged to the 27%, let alone the 42% we're seeing south of the border. In the same way, in relation to the National Improvement Framework, we've sought to engage in that debate. I think the way in which the consultation has been taken forward hasn't necessarily helped in that regard. But as I said earlier, there's much within the framework I think makes absolute sense. I think in terms of the focus on leadership, I think teacher professionalism, parental involvement, all of those things are aspects where the evidence shows improvement can be made and it can deliver real results. The focus on literacy and numeracy, I think, is absolutely right. George Adam referred to the Read, Write, Count campaign, but I think Cara Helton was right to draw attention to Save the Children's efforts under the Read On, Get On initiative, which I very much support. But as Sam H made clear in their briefing, there is somewhat an underplay of the extent to which happy and healthy children are children who are likely to fulfil their potential, and I think that's something that may need to be revisited within the context of the framework. But it's the obsession with national testing, previously the preserve of Conservative education spokespeople, which got again a glowing endorsement from Mary Scanlon earlier, which I believe is wrong-headed. It is this implied reference in the Scottish Government motion which prevents us from supporting that at decision time. Assessment is key to good teaching, but as the Education Committee heard in evidence, this already takes place and there is a wealth of information that is not being used, a point made, I think, very well by Alison Johnson. As Children in Scotland point out, quote, the educational inequalities that stem from socioeconomic disadvantage are complex and multifaceted. Highlighting real concerns within the sector over aspects of the framework, they accuse ministers of, quote, reducing what is a complex set of issues to an easily identifiable slogan with the hope that these issues will be amenable to equally short-term solutions. Turning briefly to the issue of funding and in particular the attainment fund, as I said earlier, this is fine in principle, but I believe that in practice is flawed. The pupil premium, which we support, is targeted at the need of the individual. It seems to bear some relation to the Fair Start initiative that Ian Gray was referring to. And I thought his description of a salami slicing and a re-announcing of this fund was absolutely apposite. Set in the context also of a £500 million cut to council budgets, it's hard not to see how this works entirely against the grain of what the government is saying in relation to education and indeed children's services. Stuart McMillan referred to the teacher numbers guarantee, but as councils have pointed out, in order to honour this agreement, what we're seeing is the laying off of classroom assistants, learning assistants, other staff within schools, as well as additional support for needs. Teachers. It's hard to see how this won't impact most significantly on the education or services on which those from the most deprived households rely most heavily. The OECD report gives the basis for optimism. Much we are doing is good. Some of it is indeed world-leading. But equally, there's enough in this report to stave off any sense of complacency. All share the ambition to create a world-class education system. So too, the objective of enabling every child to fulfil their potential, whatever their background, and wherever they live. I question, however, again, whether the obsession the government appears to have with a return to national testing in primary schools, underachievement on the early learning and nursery provision, and cuts to council funding are a recipe for achieving those aims. Thank you very much, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much. Liz Smith, no more than 6 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I think this has been a very interesting debate, which is obviously centred around the key question of what it is that actually makes an education system world class, because in previous generations, when that was the generally accepted definition of Scotland's school system, there was a fundamental policy principle, and that was one which was enshrined, I think, in the best of the Scottish Enlightenment. All people, whoever they were, whatever their background, had a democratic right to access the intellectual capital of the nation. Learning was seen as egalitarian, very rigorous in its approach, and respected by every class in society. There was a very healthy balance between what and how things were taught and learnt, and a very strict self-discipline expected to accompany the educational experience. As such, I think there was great pride taken in schools and what they stood for, irrespective of their community environment. Now, we now know that the eagerly awaited OECD report commends much on that line about Scottish education, most of it related to these traditional features. It complements schools on their egalitarian approach, on the fact that schools value their pupils for who they are rather than from where they have come. It praises the commitment and the professionalism of teachers and the general contentedness and enthusiasm of pupils, and it reflects positively on the basic principles of the curriculum for excellence, although, rather surprisingly to me, it chooses not to say very much about the accompanying assessment, and I'll come back to that in just a minute. But the report also issues some stark warnings, and let me deal with them just now. And may I begin with the curriculum for excellence, since that is clearly the centrepiece of what schools now do. Whilst praising its concept, the OECD report does say something rather worrying about its delivery. Indeed, it actually tells the Scottish Government to come up with a new narrative for the curriculum for excellence. And that's because some of the benefits have failed to materialise because there is too little clarity and too much complexity in the accompanying guidance. Now, the poor authors of that report clearly felt obliged to go through with a fine-tooth comb the teacher and parent guidance. They found 4 capacities, 12 attributes, 24 capabilities, 5 levels, 7 principles, 6 entitlements, and no fewer than 1,820 experiences and outcomes. And they rightly question, what does that all mean? Because just as teachers could tell you themselves, no one in Education Scotland or the Scottish Qualifications Agency or whatever other government quangle can actually explain sometimes what it means in plain English. And that's quite a serious charge from the OECD, and I would suggest it has to be urgently addressed. And it's also because of part of the reason why there is some growing concern around the boundaries for discrete school subjects, and 2 members in the Labour Party mentioned this, the resulting fear that we will actually end up possibly with a slightly narrower curriculum, which is actually doing everything to undermine subject choice. The curriculum for excellence was designed to deepen learning, but not to the extent where subject choice has been compromised or where some concerns about the failures of the English system could actually be mirrored in Scotland. Now, I suspect the reason why the OECD chose not to comment too much about the accompanying qualifications for CFE was because they were too new to assess. But I do find it slightly strange that very little mention was made of the qualification structure, since that's clearly a key part of measuring the success of any education system. National assessments do matter, not in the numbers taking them, as the Scottish Government is always keen to present as a key measure, but in terms of their specific results, because these results in turn depend on effective subject choice, and that's clearly a matter of concern in some schools. So there must not be any weakening of the distinction between the different subjects on the curriculum, since that dilutes the process of identifying what the pupil actually learns. It's that move that perhaps I think we've seen go a little bit too far to the how pupils learn. And that can actually threaten to undermine some of the best traditions in Scottish schooling. Now, it's also the reason why the First Minister, in our view, is absolutely right to put more emphasis on the learning and testing of the 3 R's, most especially, I have to say, at the end of Primary 7. And to all those who have very grave doubts about tests, I do think it is time for them to come up with some specific evidence as to why it is that we've had a decline in some of the basic standards for quite a long period of time now, since actually there has been a lack of consistent and standardised testing. I think that's an answer that is important. It's not about having more tests, it's about better quality tests, and it's about a healthy balance between formative and diagnostic testing. That's the most important thing. And can I just make a plea once again that the Scottish Government should have a look at going back into the PIRLS and TIMSS international data, because I think they are very important when it comes to that quality of assessment. Presiding Officer, at the end of the day, there are some very good things happening, excellent things happening in Scottish education, but there are some very worrying things too. There are aspects of declining literacy and numeracy. A third of schools are failing to reach at least good when it comes to inspections. There is a deficiency in hours, as my colleague Mary Scanlon said, in teacher training in literacy and numeracy. There are declining teacher numbers, including those in nursery level, when we've just agreed that early years are so important. There are declining applications for headships. And, of course, there is the awful attainment gap. So there is lots and lots for us to take from this that is positive, but there are also a lot of very stark messages, and I hope that the Cabinet Secretary will address these in her summing up.
Thank you. I now call Mark Griffin. No more than 8 minutes, Mr Griffin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the opportunity to contribute to this debate, one which has again shown that there is a growing cross-party consensus on tackling the attainment gap. As the saying goes, the first step to fixing a problem is recognising that there is one. After 8 years in government, I commend the Cabinet Secretary for speaking honestly about the challenges that we face. I'm also encouraged that all sides of the chamber are committed to ensuring that educational inequality is a top priority for this and for the next Parliament. Now, as has been pointed out by other speakers this afternoon, there is a gap in attainment between children from poorer backgrounds and those from more affluent circumstances. Yet the report card from the Scottish Government after those 8 years does not make comfortable reading. A pupil entering primary one when the SNP began running our education system will now be hitting high school. In this period, this group of pupils have borne the brunt of education budget cuts, falling teacher numbers and the increasing attainment gap, all the time watching classmates from wealthier families pull away from them academically. The OECD report last month set out starkly what was already apparent to many of us. We are no longer world leaders in education. We are falling behind the rest of the world, and change is needed to get our education system back on track. Much of the media attention and rhetoric so far has been on the reporting requirements and national testing. Now, that's understandable as it animates the copywriters and gets stories on the news desks across the country. But on the issue of standardised testing, there needs to be some clarity, I think, from the government, and I hope the Cabinet Secretary in her closing will offer more details. COSLA have rightly raised the point that the Scottish Government has to consider carefully the information that will be put into the public domain so as to avoid encouraging league tables or putting undue stress on pupils and teachers as a result of heightened media attention. Now, it would appear that the Scottish Government have attempted to alleviate this by not publishing the results of standardised testing directly. The question remains, though, as to how ministers propose to stop league tables being created if data, while not being published by anyone, will still be available through freedom of information. But testing and reporting, Presiding Officer, are a means to an end, that end being affecting substantial improvements in the educational outcomes of disadvantaged pupils. On this side of the chamber, we believe that there is action beyond what the government is proposing that can make a difference. In the coming years, this Parliament will have a substantial suite of new powers which will open up new choices in education. We would use the additional revenues from a new 50p tax rate on the top earners in the country to redistribute money from those who can afford to pay it to those who need it most, investing additional resources over and above the government's proposals in tackling educational disadvantage. The SNP government's budget yet again slashes funding for local schools, which will make the problem even worse. We would use the Parliament's new powers to introduce a Fair Start Fund, which would give every primary school an extra £1,000 for every pupil from a deprived family. That money would go directly to head teachers so that they make the decisions, choosing from a suite of proven methods about how that money is spent best in their schools to close the attainment gap between the richest and the rest. We would also offer support to parents to enable them to learn with their children, and we would introduce a special literacy support programme for looked after children. We also believe that a strong legislative framework is needed to secure faster progress in closing the attainment gap in every part of Scotland. We particularly believe that an ambitious goal is needed to help close the socio-economic attainment gap in children's literacy. Specifically, we want to see a clear approach and ambitious timescales for making progress set out in legislation. As part of the discussions on the education bill, we are offering an amendment which would set a target of reducing the attainment gap by half in the next decade. There's a precedent there for that approach, such as national targets on fuel poverty, climate change reduction, and on child poverty eradication. It's our belief that by enshrining targets in legislation, it will clearly articulate the scale of the government's aims in relation to closing the gap. It will promote a greater public understanding of the key government priority and raise the profile of the issue. It demonstrates the changes that need to happen to make the government's priority and the government's ambition a success, and it makes sure that future governments remain committed to that vital objective. Now, achieving these goals in Scotland will require greater focus on support and improvement for the poorest children who are most likely to fall behind, whilst being consistent with the responsibilities of education authorities to support all children's attainment. It will therefore drive a more effective strategic approach to closing the attainment gap at a national and local level. As I've said, we would use the additional revenue from a new 50p top rate of tax to redistribute resources from those who can afford it to those who need it most. Ending the examples that have been given by earlier speakers of shared campus schools, where one school gets funding through the attainment fund and another doesn't. All schools who have pupils who need that additional support would get that through our funding mechanism. We would invest those additional resources over and above what the government proposes to invest to tackle educational disadvantage, to ensure that the pupils who face the greatest educational challenges have the opportunity to achieve the qualifications that they need in order to have a career in science, maths, engineering, technology, or whatever field they choose to pursue. Additional resource is only part of the answer, but an integral part. It'd be a shame, Presiding Officer, given the weight of support that we have found here in the Chamber in this debate and numerous other debates for tackling our education challenges, for tackling the attainment gap, if this opportunity were to pass us by. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Griffin. Can I call on Andrew Constance to wind up the debate? Cabinet Secretary, until five.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I'm very pleased that Mr. Gray has returned to the Chamber, because in his opening remarks this afternoon, he reflected, as he often does, along with the likes of Stuart Stevenson, on the history of education in Scotland. And he was reflecting, like others, that in Scotland we used to be world leaders in education, whether that was in the 17th century or, as he specifically mentioned, in 1965 with the introduction of comprehensive education. And he said that I, in my opening remarks, that I had claimed this history as my own. And, Presiding Officer, just for the record, I want to point out to Mr. Gray that I wasn't actually born in 1965. And I have never looked at education in Scotland through rose-tinted glasses, either past or present.
Mr. Gray.
Simply to explain, the point I was making was that over a long period of time, 50 years of comprehensivisation, we've seen more pupils leave school with more qualifications. The point I was making was the evidence from Jim Scott suggests that for a significant section of young people, that trend may be endangered now, and I think that's something we need to pay attention to.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I actually accept that attainment in Scotland is increasing, and that's according to that report that Mary Scanlon often refers to in Audit Scotland. You know, over a range of measures over the past decade, we can demonstrate that attainment in Scotland is increasing. But with reference to Dr. Scott's work, I know he is a passionate advocate in particular for languages. I don't always agree with the conclusions that he reaches in his analysis. I don't necessarily agree how he has applied his research in terms of the changes in our curriculum, or indeed taking a snapshot of attainment and achievement at S4, when the purpose of Curriculum for Excellence is far more focused on looking at attainment and achievement in young people by the time they leave school. But nonetheless, you know, I recognise his interest in this area and some of his, you know, interesting remarks about local accountability and governance and decisions that are taken at a local level. But I hope that across this chamber that we would all accept that it is indeed good news that the number of entries and passes and higher grade languages has indeed went up over the past year and over the term of office of this government, and that is something to be celebrated. But the point that I want, maybe later, but the point I wanted to make about never looking at education in Scotland through rose-tinted glasses, either past or present, is that I'm not saying that we have never had a proud history or that we have never been top of the league. But we have to accept that iniquity in education is not new. It has always been with us, whether it's pre or post introduction of comprehensive education. Because for many of us, we'll only have to look at our own families. My grandfather, despite passing his 11 plus and going to the grammar school in West Lothian, that was Bathgate Academy, still had to leave school at 14 to go down a pit. My mother, who left school in the late 60s, post-introduction of comprehensive education, left school with better qualifications than my father, but was always paid far less. So we have to face up to the iniquities in our system, past and present, and not demit or demur from that challenge that places on us all. And the debate about Scotland's history in education is, of course, important and it's interesting, but the future is far, far important. And today's debate has been about a seminal report on Scottish education. And we've heard various reports from various speakers who've highlighted particular aspects of that quote. And the quote that I want to mention in my closing remarks is from Andy Hargreaves, member of the OECD review team, because this quote encapsulates our recent journey and what we need to do next. And he says, Scotland has taken a bold and brave direction in developing an engaging and challenging approach to learning that is driven by the expert judgments of a strong teaching profession. If it builds on this impressive foundation, Scotland can, should and will become a world leader of positive educational change. To do this, Scotland will need to ensure that its curriculum achieves equity as well as excellence for all pupils from all backgrounds, wherever they live. It will need to communicate the effects of its educational efforts through a clearer narrative of progress and track that progress through better indicators of impact. And it's an already strong profession. We'll need to collaborate even more closely among schools, across local authorities and with the wider community to achieve its vision. To be bold is to be admirable, to stay bold and to become bolder still in ways that benefit every learner is essential.
Liz Smith. I thank the Cabinet Secretary for intervening, for taking the intervention. I think you're absolutely right on that comment. Could I ask yet again, when it comes to the actual delivery of the curriculum for excellence, the OECD report did ask for a new narrative. Could you say something about how that might be delivered, Cabinet Secretary?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, indeed, and I concur with the need for less complexity and more clarity, and I will be discussing that very point with the Curriculum for Excellence Management Board when I meet them tomorrow. But picking up on some of the other remarks made by colleagues, colleagues will be aware that a new group on qualification and assessment has been established. And that's about getting the right balance, getting some more clarity, but getting the right balance in terms of that burden of assessment, but neither letting standards slip. Many speakers spoke about the importance of transitions between primary 7 and S2, and I agree with that entirely. I would also point to the importance of transitions from early years to primary 1 and also post-school transitions as well. And we do indeed need to get the balance between universal provision, whether it's attainment advisers, the new innovation fund announced by the First Minister, or the access to education fund, that has to be balanced with a more targeted use of resources through the Scottish Attainment Challenge, £100 million over 4 years. And it would seem to me, Presiding Officer, that the only person that is obsessed with national testing is Liam MacArthur. And can I stress to Liam in the time that I have left that we are not returning to the high-stakes national testing of the past. And I would urge him to stop fighting the battles that are long gone and to look to the future, because he says there's no shortage of data in the system. It's just not available and it's not consistent. I'll give way briefly.
Briefly, Mr MacArthur.
I'm grateful to the Education Secretary for giving way. She talks on the one hand about not returning to high-stakes testing and league tables. On the other, she keeps talking about the need for consistency across the country and for this information to be available on a national basis. So how does she square those two statements?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I would urge Mr MacArthur, one, to read the National Improvement Framework and to look at the consultation document and also the document that highlights how we responded to that very detailed consultation process that we undertook. But we have to accept, as the OECD rightly points out, that current national assessment arrangements do not provide significantly robust information. Yet Scotland has the opportunity to lead this world in developing an integrated assessment and evaluation framework. And let me say to Mr MacArthur and others, nothing trumps teacher judgment, and education is indeed about thinking outside the box, and it's most certainly not about ticking the box. I'm often asked by members in this chamber, Presiding Officer, about what my strategy is. Well, I've never been one of those ministers who likes to sit in my office, either upstairs or in St Andrew's House, with a map of the world at my back and a glossy shelf full of strategies. My strategy, first and foremost, is about Wales, and the introduction of national standardised assessments is about having the right information at the right time to intervene to help our children progress. These are diagnostic assessments where teachers have the flexibility to use those tests at any time in the school year as and when they see fit. Presiding Officer, one of the reasons that the National Improvement Framework has been put on a statutory basis is to ensure that this government and indeed our partners in local government are subject to annual reporting, that we are both accountable and transparent. And we don't just get into that cycle of describing what the problem is, so that we have the information to intervene at the right time, in the right place, with action, Presiding Officer, firmly rooted in the real world. My obsession as a Cabinet Secretary for Education, first and foremost, is on children, and secondly, it is on front line, what we need to do to enable our teaching profession to support our staff. And as recommended by the OECD, this government will indeed, with rigour, pursue relentlessly closing the attainment gap and raising the bar simultaneously, because it's not acceptable on absolutely any level for wealth to determine educational achievement and life chances. And this government had the courage to invite the OECD in to review Education Scotland, and we have the courage to open up this debate, and we will now act in the best interests of our children.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on delivering a world-class education system. The next item of business is consideration of business motion number 15305 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, setting out a revision to the business programme for tomorrow, Wednesday 13 January. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press the request to speak button now, and I call on Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion number 15305.
Formally moved.
Thank you. No member is asked to speak against the motion, therefore I now put the question to the Chamber. The question is that motion number 15305 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The motion is therefore agreed to. There are three questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first question is that amendment number 15282.3 in the name of Ian Gray, which seeks to amend motion number 15282 in the name of Angela Constance on delivering a world-class education system, be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The Parliament is not agreed. We move to vote. Members should cast their votes now. the result of the vote on amendment number 15282.3 in the name of Ian Gray is as follows. Yes, 34. No, 84. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed to. The next question is amendment number 15282.1 in the name of Liam MacArthur, which seeks to amend motion number 15282 in the name of Angela Constance on delivering a world-class education system be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Parliament is not agreed. We move to vote. Members should cast their votes now. The result of the vote on amendment number 15282.1 in the name of Liam MacArthur is as follows. Yes, 5. No, 80. There were 33 abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed to. The next question is that motion number 15282 in the name of Angela Constance on delivering a world-class education system be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament is not agreed. We move to a vote. Members should cast their votes now. The result of the vote on motion number 15282 in the name of Angela Constance is as follows. Yes, 108. No, 10. There were no abstentions. The motion is therefore agreed to. That concludes decision time. We now move to members' business. Members who are leaving the chamber should do so quickly and quietly.